Agrarian reform in the country has had limited gains ever since it was first instituted by the government more than 45 years ago. However, resistance from landowners, the slow pace of the courts, poor enforcement of decisions, and loopholes in the comprehensive agrarian reform program has left many lands undistributed to the farmers that toil them. But aside from extending CARP, Republic Act 9700, or the CARPer law, hopes to end all of that by introducing reforms into the original CARP law. The question is the CARPer law enough? And what will the new administration do so that we may have a true agrarian, or so we may have true agrarian reform in the country? And joining us tonight in the studio, Agrarian Reform Secretary Virgilio de los Reyes. Secretary de los Reyes, good evening. Thank you for coming.
Good evening.
Well, on your shoulders rest the hopes of what? More than how many millions of farmers?
Well, the balance we have is around 1 million hectares. So that's roughly around 1 million
farmers,
beneficiaries, yes. Mm-hmm.
And of course, later on we'll go into the Hacienda Luisita case. But tell us what you're doing now. You're still fine-tuning the agenda of DAR. Why is that?
Well, you will recall that the authority to appropriate money for the CARP expired in 2008. And there was a lap, there was a gap where the DAR could not really acquire as much. So last year, the accomplishment of DAR fell drastically. Second, the targets that we have up to 2014 is to finish the remaining 1 million or so hectares. So, and these are the lands which are the most contentious of the CARP. These are the lands which are owned by large landowners. Mm-hmm. These are the parcels of land with a lot of cases on it, mm-hmm. from simple technical descriptions to estate issues.
Mm-hmm. Because the landowners are resistant? Not necessarily.
The problem with the program is that you are actually rewarded for having a problem on the land. So if your technical description did not close, we had to file a case in court to make sure that these things would be fixed
accurate.
Up. Or if a great-great-grandfather had died, there would be an estate case that mm-hmm. had to be fixed up. Mm-hmm. So the department had a hard time in covering these parcels of land in the past several years.
Mm-hmm. Plus, there was a lack of funds as well to acquire, right?
Yes. Well, the landowners' compensation funds that mm-hmm. were given to DAR, there was always a target of around 100 plus thousand. But the money that was really given for initial landowners' compensation was way below that. Mm-hmm. So what happened was you had a lot of voluntary land transfers. We had to cover a lot of the government-owned land, which did not need compensation, mm-hmm. to be able to meet the targets. Mm-hmm. But right now, I mean, the government-owned lands are practically gone. Mm-hmm.
So fine-tuning, meaning what exactly? You're doing an inventory of all the cases, where they are in the courts?
Well, there has been an inventory, physical inventory of the titles with the Register of Deeds and the assessors. Mm-hmm. Fine-tuning means that you have to make sure that the strategies that you adopt are fine-tuned. I'll give an example. Mm-hmm. The manpower complement in Negros Occidental, which is the highest land balance or land balance in the entire country, is the same structure that you would have in a province like Ilocos Norte, which is practically none already.
So we are trying to reallocate
the personnel that we have.
I see.
To this province.
Per province. Uh-huh.
So we're trying to identify which province has a lot of balance.
I see.
And then we're trying to look at the provinces where there is no more land acquisition. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And where there is no more hardly any land acquisition, we now shift to support services along with the Department of Agriculture.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, the president is fortunate or chose you precisely because you made the study on which the new law is designed, correct?
Right.
Would that be accurate?
Right. Mm-hmm.
And I suppose you, in your study as well, identified the pitfalls and the problems.
Yes.
And so you're saying contentiousness of the distribution. What else are the other
problems? Let me hasten to add that the study was made by a team, which is commissioned by the Department of Budget and Management. Mm-hmm. One of the other problems that we're looking at are the collective titles. These are already acquired land, which are already distributed, but the determination of which parcel of land are owned by which beneficiary is still an issue. So these are what we call second-generation problems. Mm. The reason why we're trying to do this is to be able to drive investment and productivity by the farmers themselves.
So you're talking about lands that have already been distributed.
Yes.
So that you still inherit that problem?
Well, because as long as there's a beneficiary there, let's say you have 100 hectares with 100 beneficiaries, the idea there is what do you do to stabilize the ownership? Mm-hmm. And when you say stabilize, it means identifying the parcel of land which belongs to them, identifying the economic activity that should come on that land, that should go on in that land. And this is where the DA, the DAR, and the DNR are working together now.
Would this cover corporate farms? Not necessarily.
Not necessarily.
Are they different? They're more those owned by cooperatives?
These were lands owned by a family.
Okay.
And then to speed up the processing of the acquisition, the land titles were not split up and just given to the mass of, let's say, 100 farmers on the 100 hectares. We also have plantation type, let's say, the high commercial value like bananas in Region 10, 11. Okay. These were the former corporate farms, which many times were government-owned lands, which were leased by these corporations and distributed to beneficiaries now.
What is the problem there? It's because the farmers don't really realize the benefits of being an owner? What is the problem?
If it's a collective title, it is very hard to have, let's say, a contract growing agreement. Or, for example, for a farmer to be able to have stability in putting investment in his 1 or 2 hectares of land. Because theoretically, the land title is a whole thing.
So there's meaning he can't use the title to, I guess, what, mortgage or borrow?
Theoretically, he can mortgage, but the problem is the bank will say, if, of these 100 hectares, which one is really yours?
So he cannot engage in further economic activity?
It's very hard. I mean, so, there's instability in the title.
So you're saying these people who originally, who were the original beneficiaries, do not have not realized the fruits of land
not
before.
Really. They're there, but we can step up the investments made in agriculture if we are able to identify which parcel of, let's say, the 100 hectares they really own.
So each farmer will now have a title to his land.
We're not saying we need to split up everything, but what we're saying is you've got to fix up the tenurial arrangement you want. Like, for example, if you were to go into a high-value crop, like, let's say, bananas or organic farming, then it might make sense for the 100 farmers to come together. Right. But it has to be a decision made by the farmers consciously rather than a situation brought upon
dictated
them by the fact that the land is not yet split up.
Or dictated to them by the previous owners.
Yeah. Sometimes that happens.
Because the previous owners are also stockholders, right? In such an arrangement?
No, not in this situation. You're talking about the stock distribution option.
Okay.
This one, the lands are physically awarded to them and the landowners are paid compensation. In the stock distribution, it's different. The landowner and the farmers become shareholders in one corporation.
Okay, that's like Hacienda Luisita.
Yes, and around 13 or 12 more.
And the Cohuangco, Danding Cohuangco owned?
No, if I recall correctly, the Danding Cohuangco is an outright land distribution. But there is an arrangement made between the farmer beneficiaries and the ECJ Farms or Cohuangco. So this is not a stock distribution option that happened with ECJ.
Will you look into that as well? Is there a problem?
In previous years, I recall there were some complaints about this. And there are still some beneficiaries who are still running after control over the Cohuangco Farms. I have not gone over all the cases pending the department, but if there is a complaint or a petition to review this, then this will be part of the review.